गुरुर्ब्रह्मा गुरुर्विष्णु गुरुर्देवो महेश्वरः गुरु साक्षात् परब्रह्मा तस्मै श्री गुरवे नमः। समस्त जन कल्याणे मुरतं करुणामयं नमामि चिन्मयं देवं सद्गुरुं ब्रह्मविद्वरम्। ॐ पाठाय प्रतिबोधितां भगवता नारायणेन स्वयं व्यासेन रचितां पुराणमुनिना मध्ये महाभारतम् अद्वैतामृतवर्षिणीं भगवतीं अष्टादशाध्यायिनीम् अहं मत्वा मनुसङ्गतामि भगवद्गीते भवद्वेषिणी यं ब्रह्मा वरुणेन्द्ररुद्रमरुतः शृण्वन्ति दिव्यैस्तवैः वेदैः साङ्गपदक्रमोपनिषदैः गायन्ति यं सामगाः ध्यानावस्थिततद्गतेन मनसा पश्यन्ति यं योगिनः यस्यान्तं न विदुःसुरासुरगणाः देवाय तस्मै नमः देवाय तस्मै नमः।
Hello, salutations to all. So we begin the 14th chapter of the Geeta, lesson number 23. This chapter is called Gunatraya Vibhaga Yoga, the chapter which is about the three gunas, Gunatraya. So 13th chapter we saw about Purusha and Prakriti, and we also saw that Prakriti is actually made up of three gunas, Sattva, Rajas and Tamas. How our mind is influenced by these three gunas and how we can understand the three gunas and use them effectively, not get used by them, and to transcend that attachment to the three gunas. That is basically this chapter. So our mind has a lot of power. The chapter on three gunas is also to be able to invoke that power of the mind. Whatever we desire, we can achieve through the mind. The mind's capability is that. Why? That we will see as we go along. Whatever we focus on single-pointedly, we can attract, we can visualize, we can materialize it also. The power of the mind is such. To think that we can't achieve what we want to, or there are obstacles on our way, or we won't be able to achieve, our mind is very weak. These are thoughts which are not in line with what the mind is really made for. To change anything outside, to achieve anything that we want to achieve outside, our mindset has to change first. So there are many methods, auto-suggestions, self-hypnosis, many things which are there by which we can train our mind. What does spiritual knowledge tell us? If our mind remains in a sattvic state, we will be able to achieve whatever we want to achieve. A mind which is highly sattvic is a mind which is extremely alert, creative. We will see the three gunas as we go along. That mind can use Rajoguna also and achieve what it has to achieve. So this approach we will see, that how by changing something inside we are able to achieve something outside, whatever we want to achieve, as well as if we want to bring about any change in the society also, the mind of the individuals has to change. So when we say mind of the individuals have to change, in general we may say from negative become more positive, from dullness become more enthusiastic, but What does Vedanta say? The same thing which is put in us in a appealing language is Vedanta is saying from Tamas come to Sattva, from Rajas come to Sattva. So the deeper understanding of the modes of the mind are very important to be able to use these modes and not to get used by them. So whatever our mind will think, whatever it thinks, it will just experience it. It will make it real. Especially our brain does not know what is the difference between outside and inside. And because it doesn't know what is the difference between outside and inside, it's very important to be alert what goes on inside, because that is what will manifest outside. Suppose we see an apple, or let us say we are seeing this thermos. Now when we are seeing the thermos with the eyes, what part of the brain lights up? If you measure and if you record, it will be very interesting that when you close the eyes and visualize the thermos, you are not seeing it outside, so called outside, but you are imagining it in the mind. Same parts of the brain will light. The brain doesn't know actually the difference between outside and inside. This division of outside and inside has been created based on the body. What does that mean? Brain is an equipment which communicates with its own self. More than 70 to 80% of the communication of the brain is with its own self. So what type of thoughts we entertain, that itself will become our reality. Outside need not be anything separate. If I keep thinking the thoughts which are sad, defeatist, depressing, my mind will be such, my outside reality also will become like that. And outside may be most challenging circumstance, but if my mind remains very positive, the things outside also will change. So the mind has to be used very, very carefully. It's a very subtle equipment. You know, we are so alert about our phone, scratch guard, privacy guard, then phone case, and phone should not fall. So alert about the phone. Mind is 1,000 times more subtler than that. But our mind keeps falling anywhere and everywhere. Keeps going into the sense objects, keeps doing whatever it wants to do, entertains negative thoughts. It is such a subtle equipment, and if we use it very well, we can achieve everything that we want. And so our thoughts will affect us tremendously. Dr. Emoto, you know, he did that research. Did I share with you? The research of Dr. Emoto. Dr. Emoto from Japan, he did the research on what impact thought has on water. Very interesting.
Yes.
Let's see. I'll just show you some slides of that. This is the research of Dr. Emoto. Okay. So he says here, water is a very malleable substance. Its physical shape easily adapts to whatever environment is present. But its physical appearance is not the only thing that changes. The molecular shape also changes. In this sense, water not only has the ability to visually reflect the environment, but it also molecularly reflects the environment. What does that mean? So what they did is, water from these mountain streams, water from polluted toxic industrial areas, they have taken all this water and they show the molecular structure. See, undistilled water, this is the molecular structure. From this river, Shimanto River, is the last clean stream in Japan. This is the molecular structure. From a natural spring, this is a molecular structure of water. Antarctica ice, this is a molecular structure. This is the polluted river, Yodo River, which pours into the Bay of Osaka. This river passes through most of the major cities. This is a molecular structure. Then they did something very interesting. They subjected water to music, to prayer, and the molecular structure changes. This is the structure of water of Fujiwara Dam before offering prayer. This is the structure after offering prayer. The same water in a container. Before prayer, this is the structure. After prayer, this is the structure. Different types of music, molecular structure changes. Heavy metal music, this is the structure. You make me sick, I will kill you. If those kind of thoughts are there, this is the structure. Thank you, this is the structure. Love and appreciation, this is the structure. How much it changes, you see. So the idea is, if thoughts can do that to water, what they can do to us, our own body. There is a lot of research done on this. Some people accept this, some people don't accept it. But the idea is that our mind has this much of power. If we don't understand this power of the mind, what all happens to our body, we don't even know. Today so many people tell us, the psychological, psychosomatic diseases. So many of these are because of our own thoughts. The body gets affected. Stress is such a big cause of diseases. It's all because of the mind. So our thoughts definitely affect us, and hence in the Gita also Bhagavan tells us Nitya Sattva Sthava, Arjun remain in Sattva Guna at all times. Rajas and Tamas are required, but one should not get overwhelmed by them. So all of us have the body, mind and intellect, the same equipment made up of five elements. Yet what is that which makes us so unique and different from each other? Is the combination of the three gunas. So as the mood is, so is the mind. As the mind, so are the actions. As the actions, so are the achievements. So all the three gunas affect us. And how strange it is that nobody teaches us these three gunas. Should this not be taught in our school? This has nothing to do with religion. It's the three moods of the mind. I should know these three gunas. Tamas, Rajas, Sattva. If I don't know, and how to use these and how not to get affected by these, I should know these things. Then only I can maximize my productivity. Then only I can be happy in life, achieve what I want to achieve. So these are three moods, three gunas. In and through whatever we do, this 14th chapter begins with that, that all that action that we do, in and through all those actions, what are we seeking? We are seeking supreme perfection or supreme happiness. Let us chant the first verse. Om Shri Paramatmane Namaha. Atha Chaturdasho Dhyayaha. Shri Bhagavan Vacha. Param Bhuya Pravakshyami. Jnananam Jnanam Uttamam. Yajnatva Munaya Sarve. Param Siddhimito Gataha. So he says, Param Bhuya Pravakshyami. Again, O Arjun, I will tell you. Because 13th chapter ended and Arjun doesn't have any question. But Bhagavan felt that I spoke about Prakriti, I spoke about three gunas. Now let me explain about the three gunas. So he says, Param Bhuya Pravakshami, Jnananam Jnanam Uttamam. I will explain to you the supreme amongst all knowledge. Yajnatva Munaya Sarve, having known which all the great rishis, Param Siddhimito Gataha, they have attained perfection. Muni literally means not somebody who is a monk. That is one meaning. But literally Muni means one who is thinking. Manana Shilavan. That means all of us. Don't say Muni means only somebody who has renounced the house and gone. That is one category, one meaning of it, that's all. But otherwise Muni, so when he says Munaya Sarve, meaning all the thinking people, all who have questions, who have thoughts, who have analyzed, who are seeking, they have attained this supreme perfection. Param Siddhi Mito Gataha. And what is this supreme perfection? That state of supreme happiness and bliss, gaining which nothing remains to be gained. In and through all that we are doing, is we are seeking this perfection. But to experience that perfection, the mind must be controlled first. Because that state of perfection is beyond the mind. Because that which is permanent cannot be within the mind. Mind keeps changing. That which is permanent is beyond the mind. To experience that consciousness, happiness which is beyond the mind, right now though it is our nature, we are not experiencing. Why? Because there is attachment to the body, mind. That we have to transcend. How to transcend that? We can't just drop it. This chapter will tell us about how to step by step transcend the attachment to the three gunas and transcend the mind itself. If I transcend the three gunas, I transcend the mind. Now to transcend the three gunas, I must understand the three gunas and then know how they operate and then transcend them. So this chapter, he says, a person who will experience this Param Siddhi, supreme perfection, the chapter will tell us also how to rise above each guna, tell us about each guna, how to rise above each guna, and also what is the quality of that person, what are the qualities of the person who has transcended the three gunas. That's the last part of this chapter, which is called Guna Atita Lakshan. So who is this Guna Atita, who is poised under all circumstances, who can face all the challenges, who can handle any change without resistance. Such a person is shaken, unshaken even by birth and death. The second verse actually says that. Idam jnanam upashritya. Mama sadharmya magataha. Sarge pino pajayante. Pralayena vyathanti cha. So he says, idam jnanam upashritya. Anchoring in this knowledge, when a person lives in the world, what happens? Mama sadharna magataha. That person becomes one with the self. And remains then unaffected. Sarge pina upajayante prayena vyathanti cha. Not even creation and dissolution will affect this person. So strong and firm is the abidance in the absolute self. Our condition is exact opposite. One maid does not come in the morning, finished. Our whole mind will be disturbed. Somebody doesn't reply our message after having read it, our mind will be disturbed. Here is somebody whose mind will not be disturbed even with creation and dissolution, such mighty events. That's the power of this knowledge. So now how do I achieve this perfection? The only way to experience this perfection is to know the self, which is beyond the body, mind, intellect. That is already perfect by nature. Anything that is perfect cannot be created now, because anything created will get destroyed. Self is of the nature of perfection. So one who becomes, one who identifies with the self that this is my true nature, is the one who experiences that perfect happiness, supreme bliss. And how to experience that then? Mind has to be understood. From where we have to rise higher. Right now identification is with the mind, with the body. One has to steadily rise above that. So this chapter will tell us about this. Three steps of this chapter are: know the mind, tune the mind, transcend the mind. We have seen these three earlier also, through other different methods. Through Karma Yoga also we have done this, through Bhakti Yoga also we have done this. Now this is through the three Gunas. See, the reason is that there are different types of temperaments of people. The path of three Gunas doesn't require any faith in God. One can use the three Gunas as qualities. From Tamas rise to Rajas, from Rajas to Sattva, and then finally, when one comes into Sattva Guna, anyway will inquire, come to know about consciousness, God, and they both are one, and one will realize the Supreme. But the initial path doesn't require. And hence it can be universally applied to anybody, three Gunas. So the Gita gives this special, last six chapters of the Gita, 13 to 18, they have a lot of emphasis on three Gunas. So 14th chapter will tell us about the three Gunas. Then 17th chapter you will see how these three Gunas affect us in terms of food, sleep, then the tapas, then the speech, then the charity, different aspects, how the three Gunas affect us. And then again 18th chapter we will bring this out in three types of actions, three types of actors, three types of knowledge, three types of happiness. So this 14th chapter, three Gunas, becomes a good strong foundation for the next remaining chapters and to understand how the play of three Gunas is. Very, very practical. You can directly apply in one's life and understand, oh, right now the mind is tamasic, oh, now it is rajasic, now it is sattvic, and how to shift. Otherwise we don't even know the mind and how it plays and what are the moods, how to control it, no idea. So three Gunas help us to do that. So now, to know the mind, what is the mind? Standard definition of all of us know is, mind is a flow of thoughts. The quality of the thoughts is the Gunas. Sattva, Rajas and Tamas is the quality of the thoughts. Like the water, no? The quality of water determines the quality of the river. Same way, what is the quality of my thoughts? That determines the quality of the mind at that moment. Sattvic, Rajasic, Tamasic. Predominantly, what guna the mind remains in, that person is predominantly of that guna. Predominantly, the mind is occupied with thoughts of the Supreme, or with creative thoughts, or with innovative ideas. Then, predominantly, that person is a sattvic person. Predominantly with ambition, achievement, success, or attachment, rajasic. Predominantly with laziness, lethargy, indulgence, carelessness, and tamasic. That is predominance. All the three gunas are there in all of us. But which one predominates, that becomes the nature of that person. The mind and the temperament of that person. So to swing from this one mood to another is the natural quality of this mind, because it is born out of Prakriti and Prakriti operates in three gunas. What we must understand is only this, that these three gunas should not control us. And the mind will swing. So how does this, why do we say that the mind will naturally swing? Because what is the origin of the mind? From Purusha. The power of this Purusha is Prakriti. This Prakriti is made up of three Gunas, Sattva, Rajas and Tamas. The whole creation comes out as a combination of these two. In 13th chapter we saw that Purusha and Prakriti come together, then creation happens. Now when this creation happens, from the creation, from the Prakriti come the five elements. Space, air, fire, water, earth. From each of these five elements, different things come out. From the sattvic aspect of five elements, the senses of knowledge and action, and the collective aspect of five elements, the mind comes out. From the rajasic aspect of five elements, senses of action and pranas, they come out. And the tamasic aspect of five elements, what happens? They go through mixture and the body is made. So this body is made up of this gross five elements, the mind and the pranas and the sense faculties. They are made from the five subtle elements. Those of you who have learned Tattva Bodh, you know this. What is the point of knowing this? Our mind is much more subtler, much more powerful, much more capable. Knowledge is the inherent quality of mind, because it is made up of sattvic aspect of five elements. Detachment is the inherent quality of mind. Peace is the inherent quality of mind. Freedom is the inherent quality of the mind. But we don't know this. So from the sattvic state, we have fallen to rajasic, tamasic state. So the mind is a victim of laziness, lethargy, greed, insecurity, attachment. Whereas its own nature is what? It is made up of five elements, sattvic aspect of five elements. Detachment is its nature, peace is nature, happiness is the nature. And that's why when we are in these, our mind is most comfortable. When we are not in this, then there's disturbance, there's agitation, we don't like it. So the 14th chapter is to understand this aspect, that our mind is so much more subtler than the body, than the world of objects. Why is it that today this mind has become a victim of these? If I don't get a cup of coffee in the morning, I will have a headache. If you know this particular person doesn't behave like this, then I feel miserable. If I don't get a promotion, I feel sad. So many things keep happening. We allow so many things to victimize us and make us feel miserable, because we have forgotten the true nature of the mind, is sattva guna. So this is to understand this aspect, that mind by itself is inert and changing. What is that which gives the capacity to the mind to feel, to think? Is consciousness reflecting in this sattva guna, in this mind? Then I feel, I know, I think, I perceive, I see, I hear, I taste, I smell, I touch. But who am I truly? I am the consciousness identifying with the mind. I have become the jiva, perceiver, feeler and thinker. Now if I am in sattva guna, then I can discriminate very clearly. I am consciousness, this is an equipment. But if I am in rajo guna, I will not be able to discriminate. So what will the mind feel? I am this body. I am this Mr. So-and-so. And whatever this Mr. So-and-so is going through, I am going through. That is how we are in bondage. Tamas and Rajas, they will always bind. Sattva Guna will liberate. So to understand this properly is what we need to study this chapter for. That how Sattva, Rajas and Tamas, they operate. And once I understand this, then how I should live in sattva guna most of the time. And remember, all the three gunas, they will cause bondage. But only thing is, sattva guna is better aspect than rajas and tamas. Because through sattva I can exit, I can get out of false identification with the body, mind and intellect. Through rajas and tamas, I will go more deeper into bondage. So prakriti itself has two gunas which bind us and one guna which liberates. For a seeker, that's why sattva guna is most crucial. We will see how to cultivate and how to increase sattva guna also. So in this chapter, Bhagavan goes ahead to explain this, that how his prakriti becomes the cause and how this whole creation is pervaded by these three gunas. See verse number 3. Mama yonir mahat brahma.
Mama yonir mahat brahma.
Tasmin garbham dadhamyaham.
Tasmin garbham dadhamyaham.
Sambhavasarva bhutanam.
Sambhavasarva bhutanam.
Tato bhavati bharata.
Tato bhavati bharata.
So he says, Mama Yoni Mahat Brahma. Prakriti is the Yoni. It is also called Mahat Brahma. tasmin karmam dadamyam. Purusha, as though enlivens his prakriti. Then, sambhava sarva bhutanam. Then the whole creation manifests. Tato bhavati bhagata. So the Purusha enlivening prakriti, and then prakriti becomes a material cause of the whole universe. Purusha becomes the intelligent cause of the whole universe. And both of them together create this whole universe. It is so clearly distinguished between matter and consciousness. When we say that, you know, I believe in nature but I don't believe in God, we are basically saying we believe only in the material cause of the creation, not intelligent cause. How can there be no intelligent cause of the creation? Material cause by itself doesn't replicate itself or duplicate itself to now appear as all this. There is an intelligent cause. So Purusha is the intelligent cause, Prakriti is the material cause. And material cause also means instrumental cause. Together, then this creation comes out. So vasanas also are of these three types: sattva, rajas and tamas. Sattvic vasana will create a sattvic desire, rajasic desire, tamasic. Sattvic desire, sattvic thoughts, sattvic actions. That cycle, they are affected by the colors, by the gunas, three gunas. So the idea here is that when this whole creation is created, the cause is that which pervades the whole creation. What is the material cause? Is Prakriti. Now the material cause is that which pervades this whole universe, like the mud pervades all the pots. In that same way the Prakriti pervades whole universe, and Prakriti is made up of three gunas. So the whole universe also will be made up of three gunas. These three gunas, when they are in state of equilibrium, Samyavastha it is called, there is no creation. When this equilibrium is disturbed, then creation starts. How does that equilibrium get disturbed? Through what desire? No, we don't believe all this. Simply some theory is being cooked up. How can we believe? Every night it happens to us. When we are in the state of deep sleep, are you in sattvic state? Rajasic state? We say tamoguna only because I don't know. Ignorance is overwhelming. But in the state of deep sleep, the gunas are in samyavastha, equilibrium. Does anybody have a rajasic deep sleep? What happened to you in deep sleep? I am very active and tired. Kicking and all that. Nothing. That will happen in dream state, not in deep sleep. Worst criminal also will have same deep sleep as a saint. No difference. Because all the three gunas will go into dormant state. A king and a beggar will have same deep sleep. Then what is the point? He is having so much of riches and, you know, he is sitting in the palace and sleeping on the luxury of his bedroom, and the beggar is on the road. But deep sleep wise, both are same, no difference at all. When the person comes out of deep sleep, when that desire arises, some karmic consequence and a desire disturbs the deep sleep, and person comes out into dream, and then further disturbance comes out into the waking. Our whole life process goes on like this only. When the mind gets disturbed, one comes into dream, then into waking state, and from that disturbance, when the mind withdraws, it goes into dream, into deep sleep. This keeps happening. So when the gunas, same thing you apply in the creation. So the Upanishads say, sa ikshata lokanusruja iti. In the beginning there was only one supreme creator, consciousness, not even creator. Then what happened? He desired, sa ikshata, that may I become many. Ekoham bahu syama, I am one, may I become many. Now the desires are risen in the thought, in the consciousness. Now it becomes many. So Purusha, Prakriti, then the whole creation happens. This intermingling of these three gunas is what causes creation. And because this permutation and combination is what causes the whole variety, it is important to understand, because how do people relate, how do beings relate? Compatibility, no, nowadays they say compatibility. That compatibility is based on these three gunas. They should be compatible to each other. Relationships, people, beings. Even for equipments, we have compatibility. You can pair up this computer with Apple MacBook. You can pair up with an iPhone. Compatible. You try pairing up this Apple with a Windows phone. Not compatible. So, compatibility. Same way in the three in this whole world, the gunas make up the compatibility. And what is that which creates this whole variety is these different combinations. Maybe you have seen this video earlier, as Gurudev gives the example of coffee in this, that how this coffee is made differently by different people. And he connects it to the three gunas.
Nobody in the world or living me who has not got the gunas. All the three gunas are everyone. A professional murderer and a wretched man, evil-minded man, even he has got sattvic moods. Even the greatest saint and saint has moments of tamas and rajas. All the three put together is called the human personality. Never can there be only one. Coffee means three things: decoction, milk, and sugar. Three things mixed together is normal coffee, not American coffee. American coffee is anything they put there, some black powder, and keep on burning, boiling in the evening, and take it a little. What do they cook? That is the tragedy of this country. Never mind. The real coffee is made artistically by mixing these three, and then you take coffee. Now, right? Now, even though this coffee contains only three things, if you on a Saturday or Sunday visit four or five friends, Hindu friends, Indian friends, when you visit, whatever be the time or the day, they will not allow you to go out without coffee. Come on, let's have a little coffee. No, I don't want it. I just now had food. Good digestion. Coffee is good. No, I just now go and take food. Very good. Is an appetizer. You won't be allowed to go without taking coffee. You go in four or five places, take coffee. Every coffee contains a thing. But no two coffees are the same. Thai. Go to a South Indian coffee. The coffee is coffee. But it's all the coffee. Milk pot and sugar pot have been brought around it, not inside. That is called the South Indian coffee. Gujarati, go there. Aiyya! The milk, the sugar the pavilions put in, it just gone for you. Sugar? Punjabi coffee? A cup of glass of milk and one drop of coffee, and sugar. And that coffee, they won't shake it because it will spread. And then take that milk on it. Coffee is only a witness that I am here. Meaning, the proportion of one to the other give different tastes. In the same way, these three ones are in every one of you. But the preponderance of one over the other gives the various tastes, the various performances, various perfume of your personality. Now let us have some music.
So how does three You know, the decoction of milk and sugar creates the varieties in coffee. Same way, three gunas create the variety in this whole creation. So these gunas are very, very subtle. They cannot be perceived with us by us directly, because mind itself is a product of the gunas. So how to understand the three gunas? By observing the effects. That in this world, what are the effects that we see? Through those effects, we understand, oh, there are these three types of gunas. So what are the effects? Three principles we see. Principles of inertia, principles of activity, and principle of balance. Inertia we see a lot. The static nature generally is inertia. Work is to put effort, then that activity happens. So we see inertia, we see lots of stones, lots of things just existing. Then we see lot of dynamism, activity, movement. We see, you know, plants, birds, rivers, so much of movement. And we also see balance. Peace, quietude, balance. All the three principles you will see. Everywhere within us, in nature, outside us, we will see all the three are functioning. So when they see these, then one infers that, oh, there must be these three gunas. And all the three gunas are very important. See, don't think that we don't need gunas. Gunas are needed. If we don't have tamas, we can't sleep. We can't even rest. So even you see those people who don't get sleep, some of the conditions that are told, no, for getting sleep. So they will say that you must black out the whole room, light should not come, sound should not be there. If at all, you can play some soothing music or, you know, some nice fragrance must be there, all that. To let the mind go into tamas, to avoid rajoguna, to avoid thinking, withdraw from all this. So tamas is required for sleep. Rajas is required for action and dynamism. And sattva is required for thinking and creativity. So it is not that we should not have these three gunas, or there is anything wrong with these gunas. The issue only is that these gunas have to be used by us. They should not bind us. The word guna also means a rope. So these three gunas can bind us also. If we mismanage them, see, when we have to be tamasic, that time we are very rajasic. When it is time to sleep in the night, what do we do? Some people's day starts in the night. That time keep watching TV, keep talking to people. Nowadays people don't get sleep before 1 o'clock, 2 o'clock. If somebody sleeps at 10, 10:30, they feel something abnormal with this room. They will, when they go into a new city, you know, first thing they'll inquire, how is the night life? What, how is the night life? You're supposed to sleep at night. But that's what the mind does now. When your mind has to be tamasic, it will become very rajasic. Then when it has to be satvic, it will be absolutely tamasic. 4 o'clock in the morning, I must be what? Awake and satvic. When the entire nature is having sattva guna, what I am doing? Nicely sleep. When we mismanage these, then the doctor will say, you have hyperacidity, you have ulcer, you have cholesterol, you have all kinds of problems. You need to make lifestyle changes. Very good. Welcome to the Geeta. Long time back only Bhagavan said it. The three gunas, if you manage very well, life will be in harmony with nature. So guna means a rope. Guna means that which binds also. So each of the three gunas, when we get identified with the body, mind, intellect, sattva, rajas and tamas, then we get bound. The chapter is to understand the three gunas and get out of that bondage. Because we are the truth which is transcending this. The three gunas are born from me, the prakriti is born from me, the pure consciousness. I should not be affected at all by this. I means the true self, pure consciousness. And it is fact that even right now consciousness is not affected. But we don't identify ourselves with that consciousness. We identify with the mind, and that mind is completely under the control of the three gunas. So how do I get out of that false identification and reclaim my divinity? That is this chapter. So like the electricity and the bulb, consciousness enlivens the BMI. Without it, the BMI can't function. But today the BMI is making us so confused, where I think I am the BMI. So now, let us see, what are the three gunas? What we did just now is verse number 5. Sattvam rajas tama iti guna prakriti sambhavaha nibadranti mahabaho dehe dehinam avyayam. So the three gunas, they bind the person, because guna also means the rope. Now how do we untangle ourselves? So we have to understand the three gunas. So let us see verse number 6. Tatra sattvam nirmalatvat prakashakamanamayam sukha sangena badnati jnana sangena chanagha. So what is the main feature of sattva guna? The main feature of sattva guna is knowledge and balance. Calmness, serenity, peaceful. Person who has sattva guna will know clearly what is right, what is wrong. There is a discrimination which is very sharp. Person will be detached, happy in spite of whatever is there or whatever is not there. And it is felt by us as peace, joy, love, compassion, all this. This is generally about sattva guna. What does this 14th chapter tell us? Tatra sattvam nirmalatvat, free from impurities. Mala means kama, krodha, lobha, moha, mada, marsalya, all these. Free from impurities. Meaning purity is the quality of sattva guna. Our Gurudev used to say this, that when purity of the mind is there, then only what knowledge we have, we will translate. So he used to say, knowledge can destroy, but wisdom alone saves. Why? Because if knowledge is not accompanied by purity, it can destroy us. Bhasmasur, what did he ask for himself? He said, whatever I touch should become ash. And what did he want to do? He wanted to touch Shivji only. Ultimately what happened? Mohini avatar of Bhagwan happened, and then that Mohini avatar, while dancing, made this Bhasmasur touch his own head, destroyed. Knowledge is there, tapasya is there, but purity of the mind is not there. He destroyed himself. Knowledge is there in everybody, smoking kills, but not enough purity, so one destroys oneself. So wisdom saves, not just knowledge. That knowledge accompanied by purity becomes our wisdom. So sattva guna is very important. If I am getting knowledge which is not happening, which is not translating in my life, that is not the fault of knowledge, that is the fault of my purity. Means I must increase my sattva guna, especially in the subjective realm. Suppose I am learning so much about the Geeta and detachment and single-pointedness and selfless work and all this, and yet I am very attached, I still feel very insecure, then don't say that what is the purpose of this Geeta study, nothing happened. Geeta study is not going to make that change. If I feel convinced and I put the effort, then that attachment will go, insecurity will go, that's effort that I have to put. So sattva guna, tattva, tatra sattvam nirmalatva. Then prakashakam, of the nature of illumination and knowledge. The mind which has sattva guna wants to know, is curious, is inquisitive, is in wonder. So when people tell, no, so many people who are great achievers, they go on telling, learn to be a student, learn from every experience of life. Constantly be a learner. Your knowledge should not stop. That is this sattva guna. If sattva guna is there, then person keeps on gaining more and more. Learns from everything. Just by observing, so much one learns. Even if you are standing at a juice shop drinking juice, how that fellow cuts the fruit. Have you seen that? Very efficiently they do. They'll take a mango, 1, 2, 3, 4, over, mango is cut. How they will cut the watermelon, you see. Very interesting. One can learn. I'm just giving one simple example. So much to learn from everybody. Tatra sattva nirmalatvat prakashakam. Anamayam. Free from suffering. Psychosomatic suffering is not there. So the body is very healthy. Sukha sangena. Is always calm, cheerful, happy. Sattva guna is that. Especially when the mind goes into the state of meditation, japa, etc., the mind becomes calm, peaceful, quiet. Because sattva guna is increasing. Jnana sangena. Now this sattva guna also is that which will make the person gain the knowledge of the self. Subtle knowledge. Earlier when prakasha is said, is knowledge. We refer to the world outside. The jnana here is knowledge within. A subtle knowledge of the self, the knowledge of dharma, adharma, atma, anatma, all that. These are qualities of sattva guna. Here what does Bhagavan say? Sukha sangena badhnati jnana sangena chanaka. Though these are qualities of sattva guna, sattva binds us by making us attached to knowledge and to sattvic sukha, sattvic joy. The chapter here is to understand the three gunas and the bondage that the three gunas create. So for a seeker who is in the level of tamas, the person is attached to bhoga, complete indulgence. Person who is in rajas is attached to karma, lot of activity. And a person who is seeker of knowledge, is in sattva guna, is attached to knowledge. Sometimes one becomes fanatic also about one's knowledge. Sometimes one becomes very rigid. What I know is correct, I won't accept anybody else's opinion. Sometimes one becomes very attached to the sense of quietude. So if children are running around, what one will tell? So much noise they are making. Now in school is very interesting. When we used to study, one period is 45 minutes. After two periods, we will have one interval. In that interval also, there are monitors who are appointed to stand in the corridor. And what are they appointed for? Children should not run around. Children are bubbling with so much of energy, enthusiasm and all that. And what the effort of the school is? Sit quietly. Don't shout. Don't make noise. Just listen. Don't run about. Don't do this. Don't do that. How it will be possible? So much of energy is there. Recently I saw one video. There is a school in Japan. There are no classrooms only. It is outdoor, full. And that whole school, the roof and all is made in such a way that children climb in trees, they climb on the roof, they jump, they do this, they do that. They don't have a concept of sitting inside the classroom and teaching for 45 minutes. They teach outside only, in different ways. And they want the natural tendencies of the children to be harnessed, not to be suppressed. And they have shown the difference in the results of the normal children who are studying in this school and these children who are put under a classroom and all that. Lot of difference. So the idea is that sometimes we become very intolerant to activity, dynamism. When the attachment to sattva happens, no, it will be like that. So attachment to sattva can bind us to quietude, can bind us in knowledge, can bind us in some sense of calmness. So we can't deal with certain disturbances. One has to rise above that. So this is about sattva guna. Computer also is not wanting to go beyond sattva. Doesn't like to go to rajas and tamas, I think. So one simple exercise. What do you see here?
Human figures, faces.
Tree figures. Human figures. Who are these human figures? You can see Nehru, Gandhiji, Khan Abdul Ghaffar Khan, then Bhagat Singh, Lokmanya Tilak, Subhash Chandra Bose, Lal Bahadur Shastri. There are some more here. Indira Gandhi. One more person you are missing out.
On this side.
On the left side.
Yeah.
Left side bottom.
Yeah. I can't recognize.
Now Rajendra Prasad is not there. This is Lal Bahadur Shastri. Rajiv Gandhi apparently. There is one more person you are missing out. No, Gopal Krishna Gokhale is not here. Subhash Chandra Bose. Radha Krishna. Dr. S. Radha Krishna is also here. Respects is here, na? Why are we doing this exercise suddenly?
What the mind perceives.
The idea is sattva guna is the guna of knowledge. When we see, when the mind has sattva guna, it can identify so many things in the apparently just a tree. In the same way, this whole creation, when we have sattva guna, what will I identify? I will not see this creation as just a creation. I will see this creation as Bhagavan is this whole creation. Krishna is this river, Krishna is this mountain, Krishna is this tree, Krishna is the people, everything is Bhagavan only. Don't start thinking that one form you will see. It's an intuitive understanding, oh, this is all Krishna. That's what will happen. That is sattva guna. Then rajo guna. The next verse. Rajo ragatmakam vidhi. Trishna Sangha Samudbhavam Tanni Badhnati Kaunteya Karma Sangena Dehinam. So the main feature of Rajo Guna is activity. Main feature of Sattva Guna is knowledge. Agitation, imbalance, restlessness, knows what is right and wrong but unable to follow because attachment to some pleasure. Depends always, so attachment is very strong. Only if this happens then I will be happy. Always depends on if. Sattva guna doesn't depend on if. In spite of, is always happy. Rajo guna always depends. And felt as desire, ambition, haste, passion, greed, anger, lust, all these. What does he say here now specifically? Rajo ragatmakam vidhi. Understand Rajo guna to be of the nature of attachment. Ranjanat raga. That which gives us more pleasure, where we feel that when I get this, I will become more happy. That feeling of attachment, that is raga. Rajo radhatmakam vidhi, trishna, there is insatiable thirst. No matter how much one gets, it is not enough. It's a very uncomfortable feeling actually. How strange that is. See, if we don't get and we are missing something, that is one thing. When we have got it, still it is not enough, that is a sense of insecurity, that is terrible. People love us, but they don't love us enough. Then there's a problem. We have money, but that money also is not enough. That enough also is such a relative term. Some people have enough and enough and enough for the 7th generation, but still that is not enough. Insatiable thirst. Trishna it is called. Asanga is dependence. Person will depend always on others or other things for happiness. Trishna asanga samudbham karma sanghena badnati. Will bind the person to activity and restlessness. Person can't sit quietly, cannot meditate properly. Lot of agitations in the mind, wants to do something all the time, very restless, can't sit for some time, keeps on moving. Gurudev used to say that's why people are given notepad and pen or pencil in the conference. Why? Because they can't sit quietly. If you don't give notepad and pen, they will start scratching the table, start pulling the the sofa on which they are sitting, they start pulling. They say that is more difficult to repair, more costly. So better give them notepad and let them keep scribbling. You see so many places you see. Otherwise in the school desk you will see on the table they will return so many things. They will take a blade, they will scratch it, they will make some shapes. Something the mind will do, because how much can you keep listening? 45 minutes over. One teacher went, another 45 minutes, another teacher came, then again 15 minutes break, another 45, 8 hours. Can you imagine 8 hours? We have gone through that, no? And we are free now, we feel so happy. 1.5 hours for us to go through is so difficult, which are us small boys. 8 hours has to sit through and listen. And every teacher says, don't make noise, keep quiet, don't make noise, keep quiet. It's terrible. What will they do? The energy is there. That is rajoguna. Binds to activity, binds to restlessness. I think the computer does not transcend between one guna. Something has happened to that. So rajoguna is can you see?
Yeah.
So I'm not going to put it in the play mode. If I put it in the play mode, it may disappear. See. I understood now. So rajoguna is this. Rajasic food, spicy, oily, hot, pungent. The body is very restless and mind is in rajoguna. The mind is very ambitious, greedy, insecure. The intellect is selfish, egoistic. Duryodhana and Karna are examples of that. Arjuna was the example for sattvaguna. Duryodhana and Karna, even Dhritarashtra for rajoguna. Now comes tamoguna. So the main feature is this. Dullness, inertia, ignorance, that's the main feature of tamoguna. And it expresses as carelessness, forgetfulness, inalertness. Intellect is sent to the fields, meaning doesn't want to discriminate only what is right, what is wrong. Somehow just live. Not only that, derives happiness by doing wrong things. By hurting people, harming people, harming oneself also. That is tamoguna. Felt as laziness, procrastination, exhaustion, sloth, When the mind is in tamasic state, this is what happens. So what does he say?
This Alzheimer's and dementia is...
Those are biological conditions, more than the mood of the mind. Those are the degeneration of the brain itself. Those are not induced by the mood of the mind. Those are physically induced diseases. And that's why they keep saying that keep using the brain. The more cognitive processes are done, the lesser chances of Alzheimer's. More logical deductions are done, lesser chances of all these. Of course, there is heredity factor also which plays an important role, but from our side what we can do is keep using the brain. So learn a new language. That is one of the best ways to keep the brain active. Do those brain games, you know. Those brain games are very important, very powerful. We may have done those in childhood and we may say, hey, toh bachchon ke liye hai. Lekin no. How for a child the cognitive processes and logical ability and deductions they help. Same way it will help for the adult also. Our difficulty is nowadays, what we have started doing is, we have made everything so simple that we have become useless. Then what will happen to the body? Earlier we used to dial the phone number. Now we have a phone which will store all the numbers. Earlier, suppose you get lost anywhere. Do you have any problem? You will remember somebody's number, you will go to nearest PCO, you will call. Now if we get lost and phone is not there, or is actually lost, one doesn't know now what to do. Some 1-2 numbers if you remember, then you are safe. If you don't remember that, you know, it's very interesting. In phone book they have something called ICE, you know ICE?
Yes.
ICE and ICE-1, you should put that and keep, because if you fall down somewhere or something happens to you, anybody sees your phone, they can go to ICE in case of emergency and they can call that number.
But the phones are locked.
Sometimes,
no,
that is true, they are locked and sometimes you may, then that's your problem, what can you do? Nowadays they have thumbed, you know, with that,
yes.
So that way at least they will try putting your thumb and
yes,
unlock it, do something. In phone we have ICE. But in our mind we don't have IC. Suppose I get lost somewhere, at least I have to remember one number. I must have an IC in the mind minimum. The point is, every time you are calling somebody, what I do? I first tell the number to my mind. Then only I press. Because otherwise we are not using the mind only. We are just typing the name of the person, that also we don't have to type fully. I am telling you, next generation will not even remember the
spelling.
Suppose you type Vinita, we type V-I-N, number name comes, press it, dial, oh yeah.
Now Siri directly does it.
After Siri also, you can tell directly, call Vinita, over. So don't even see the number. Eventually what is going to happen? Majority, today the ratio is what you know? 1 in 3 people are getting Alzheimer's. That's the ratio today, 1 in 3. It's just a matter of time, it will become 2 out of 3 and then 3 out of 3 if we go like this only. And artificial intelligence is going to make the life much more easy and intuitive. Machines will do everything after that. They'll start guiding us. Eat this, don't eat this. They'll start feeding us also. They are already doing surgeries. Robots are doing surgeries. You just think. Then sattva, rajas, tamas, no need to study because we will always be tamoguna. No need to do it. Machines will become more rajasic. We will become more tamasic. So the mind is laziness, lethargy, etc. We have to push ourselves. The very big challenge is to get out of tamoguna. Comfort is one of the biggest causes of tamoguna. And our life is becoming more and more comfortable. Earlier we used to make roti, now roti maker is also there. We used to wash dishes, now dishwasher is also there. Everything, there's an equipment now. Very soon human race only will become extinct, because if there is nothing to do, that's the worst thing. How will our mind survive?
Darwin.
Terrible it will become.
There's a very interesting book called The Homo Sapiens, and he talks about the evolution of mankind. And as you said, the dependency on machines is so much that there's a possibility that the brain may start reducing in size.
Yeah.
It started with a small brain, and as the man evolved, as the species evolved, the brain size became bigger. And now it's, you know, you're not using your brains as much. Even in kids, in schools, they're using tablets and calculators.
Yeah.
It's a scary situation.
We used to take extra sheet to do rough calculations.
Yes. We have calculators.
Now calculators only are taking and going. This is very, one has to ensure that this brain, tamo guna at the biological level also one should not entertain. As much one can entertain, engage, that much better the brain has to be used. So what does this 8th verse say? Tamas tvajnana jam vidhi. Mohanam sarvadehinam. Pramadalasya nidrabhihi. Tannibadhnati bharata. This tamastu ajnanajam vidhi. Tamoguna is characterized by ignorance. Tamastu ajnanajam vidhi. Mohanam sarvadehinam. It will delude everybody. Delusion means not to see something as it is, but to see it as the opposite. All this what we just now discussed is part of delusion only. We think life has become more comfortable, but the fact is we have become more dull and dependent. Delusion, that is. Mohanam sarvadehina. Pramadalasya nidravi. Pramada, carelessness. Chalta hai, it's okay, who cares. Alasya, not today, tomorrow. Procrastinate. And nidra, sleep. This is excessive sleep. All this will bind. So, sattva, rajas, tamas. Three gunas we saw. And the binding nature of three gunas also we saw. Now little more we will say about how these three gunas affect our senses, affect our life here, affect our life hereafter also. That we will take up in the next session. Now one activity has to be done by all of you, a simple one. As homework, one is till the next class, which is next Sunday, right? Or next Sunday is Chinmaya. So Chinmaya we are celebrating the second anniversary of Chinmaya Pradeep. So experientially what transformed Balan into Swami Chinmayananda, some glimpses of that we can go through. So it is open for all age groups, from children to youngsters to adults, everybody can come. It is from morning 9 o'clock to afternoon 1 o'clock, 4 hours only. There will be specific activities for children, and there will be specific workshop and other things for the elders. And we also have a Mrityunjay Havan for the whole family together. We will sit, pray for our well-being, and we are dedicating this also to the soldiers in the at the borders for their well-being. So all of you are welcome. Please do join. The announcement we will put up on the group. The registration link is there. Please come. It is a nice way to go through Gurudev's life and how he transformed and what we can learn out of that. So week after that, 17th will be our next class. So till then, one activity you have to do as homework is observe the play of the three gunas in this whole creation and identify what is sattvic, what is rajasic, what is tamasic. So awareness is, the idea is to create more awareness in the mind of the play of the three gunas outside me and then inside me. And the second thing is, we are going to celebrate the Guru Purnima. Guru Purnima comes in July end this year.